Hello, my name is Ryan Sigler, and today I'm going to show you how to upload a custom audience to Meta, aka Facebook, and also how to manipulate the format of the data to make sure that Meta, aka Facebook, can take in that data. So first and foremost, you're going to want to go to adsmanager.com/facebook.com/adsmanager/audiences. That's a mouthful, I know. But once you get here, you should see something like this. Another way to get here is once you log in under this side panel, you should go under audiences, so you could get to it that way, or you can go to all tools, and it could be up here under your shortcuts if you come here often, or it'll be down here under advertise for audiences. So, and don't put it past Meta or Facebook to change this. I'm recording this today, this could change in a month or two. Meta's known to do this. So once you get here, you're going to want to make sure that you're in the proper business manager and the proper ads manager that you're associated with the account that you want to work on. And this may look empty to you. Just depends on if you've ever created other audiences or uploaded other audiences, or someone else may have done so on your behalf. So this might be empty. In this case, I have a dummy account here. So these are all just kind of fake audiences that I'm using just for example purposes. So next you're going to want to go to create audience and click custom audience right here. Here you're going to get a bunch of different options. You can create them from your website. This is using pixel data. You can create them using your app activity if you have a connected app, etc. All these different ones. We can go into more of these next time, but today what we're going to focus on is the customer list. So go ahead and select this list and click next. From here, it's a bunch of mumbo jumbo and a bunch of stuff on how to connecting from or importing from MailChimp or downloading a file template. Don't worry, I will just speed run through this for you. So you're going to click next here. Here you get the option to upload customer value or no customer value. I typically like to include this. So if you're exporting from like Shopify or WooCommerce, and you get an Excel sheet or get a Google sheet, and it has what your customer's lifetime value was, like total purchases, then that's spectacular, because when you go later to upload this into Meta and later even create lookalike audiences, Meta will put more weight on the kinds of people who tend to spend more with your company. It doesn't treat everyone exactly equally. My only word of caution and word of advice with this is make sure that before you upload this data into Meta, you go through and you remove anyone who's like a corporate buyer, anyone who's buying like truckloads or pallet loads of product. That would skew the data in the wrong way, meaning putting way too much emphasis on like one purchaser, one or two purchasers. Typically, you know, if you have friends and family who are buying a lot of stuff through your website because they want to support you, that's awesome. But also you probably want to pull them out of this customer list because there may not be a good representation of what true valuable customers are. So anyway, with that said, I'll go ahead and select yes here, and then we'll click next. And here we can go to upload the list. However, if you just go to upload a raw export from Shopify or raw export from WooCommerce or your email list or something like that, chances are you're going to run into some issues. Meta is not able to import everything properly and track and tag what each column is and stuff like that. You would think a multi-billion dollar company who's been around for this many years would already have this automated, but they still struggle with simple things like this. So we have to do some homework. So here I have an example of some common issues that I see. Now you may not see all these issues, your export might be perfect and it might just work, but I'm gonna show you real quick how to jump through, how to manipulate and jump through some of these hoops and get it to the point where Meta will take the data. The most common issue I see is that first name and last name are combined into one column, and then also with like addresses and the titles of some of these headers sometimes will cause Meta to just go haywire. So let's fix a couple of these. First and foremost, we're gonna do this in Google Sheets. I'll show you how to do this in Excel as well. First in Google Sheets, because it's really, really quick. We're gonna split first name and last name. So first thing I like to do is I add a couple columns to the left, and I like to add one or two extra ones just for good measure. And what we're gonna do is run a little tool here that's going to allow us to split this out. Now, if I scroll down, I look through and I notice almost everyone is first name, last name, but there is someone here or a couple people here who have included their middle name, which would throw this off. And that's why I added multiple columns, just because If I don't, and I split this over, it's going to override data in the existing column. So I want to add enough extra columns here to where I feel safe, where even if someone used one, two, or even three middle names here for some weird reason, it's not going to override my other data. And I'll show you what happens. So once we've added those extra ones, you go to, you highlight the column, you go to data, and you go to split text to columns. And you get this little tool right here, the separator. You can detect it automatically. In this case, we know it's a space that separates the first name and last name. Sometimes it'll be a comma or something like that. But in this case, we'll just do space and boom, we're done. Ah, we're not quite though. We have this weird person with their middle name. So in this case, I just take their last name and I just override their middle name with it. And I scroll down until the next one, sure enough, and perfect. We don't have anyone with extra middle names, so I'm gonna remove these extra columns that I had. I do those just for safety. And then we rename these columns. So first name, last name. Now addresses is gonna be pretty similar. We can't really import all these addresses. First off, Meta doesn't even care about street address. It's just gonna throw a wrench into the whole upload. So don't even try to upload that one. So we're gonna just add some extra columns here. And we're gonna do basically, I can't highlight these two. There we go. Insert two more. We're gonna insert two more. We're gonna insert two more. So now we've got a ton of extra space here. You know what? We're gonna do one more. There we go. All right, and we're gonna run the same thing. So we're gonna go to highlight the tool, click data, split text to columns, and we look for any kind of weird addresses. And we don't have any, so that's perfect. Some examples of weird addresses would be military bases. Sometimes they'll be like an Air Force base would be like AFB, comma, dot, slash, all kinds of stuff, and it messes things up. Also, if you have international customers, sometimes their address fields could be extra long. I know like Vietnam and the Philippines have really long addresses in some other Asian countries. So in that case, just always add a lot of extra columns. If you don't, when you do this data override tool, it'll start eating up into these columns and getting rid of some of this data. So for that reason, you want to keep it clean. Now, we want to name these, but we need to get rid of some of these columns too. We can't really even take city, so we're just, or the street address, so we're just gonna delete this column altogether. And then we're gonna name city, state, country. We're gonna remove some of these. I may have gone overboard with too many extra ones, but that's fine. It's easy enough to delete them. Boy, I did. All right, we're gonna delete these two. Okay. So purchase history, Meta doesn't really care about this, so we're gonna delete that here. We have total spend. Now Meta doesn't like the word total spend. We're gonna call this value because that's what it wants. Order date doesn't really matter either, but we can delete that one. Email's very important, phone number's very important. What else do we need? Oh, we don't need customer ID here either, so we're gonna delete that. So this right here should be in good enough format for Meta to take in. What you would do then is download this as a CSV, not an Excel, not a PDF, nothing else than a CSV. Save it to your desktop and then upload it that way. So that's how you do in Google Sheets. Let's do a similar thing here with Excel. So in this case, we're gonna do the same thing. We're gonna add extra columns to split the first name and last name. Now in this case, I know I forgot to put the middle name in here for the example purposes, so I know that there's really just two. So we're gonna click the column, we're gonna click data, and we're gonna click text to columns. Here, you're gonna click delimited, and then you can click next. In this case, I'm doing tab and space. Next, and finish, and here we go. Again, if you have people with multiple middle names and whatnot, just make sure you add enough columns to where it doesn't override the data in like another column here. So I actually did one too many, which is fine. We're gonna change this to first name, last name, perfect. Now we're gonna run into the same issue with the addresses, so let's add more columns here. I'm gonna add two more. Okay, cool. And we're gonna do the same thing, text to columns, and it should keep all of our same settings, so I'll just click finish, and it sure enough did. We had one extra, which we can delete now. So we don't need city. Oh, in this case, it actually broke this out even more. We don't need the street number. We don't need the street. Well, we don't need the acronym of the street. So we can get rid of all three of these. So now we just have city, state, country. And next, we don't need customer ID, so we're gonna get rid of that. And let's see, we don't need purchase history, so we're going to get rid of that. We're going to keep total spend, but we're going to change its name to value, remember? And then we don't even need order date. And so now we've got phone number, email, value, country, state, city, last name, first name. And if you had zip code, you can include zip code as well. And my example here, I didn't provide zip codes, but that's fine. So now you're going to save this as a CSV file. So make sure it's CSV, make sure it's not an XLS or, you know, anything else. It's got to be CSV. Name it what you want to name it. In this case, I'm going to name it example customer data. Click save and go back to Meta. Now we're going to go to upload. So now we're going to take that uploaded or that saved file. We're going to upload it into Meta. You're going to still get a weird error. You would, the value column should be the values or positive numbers. Ah, so sometimes if you get that error, that's a 50-50 error. I don't get that error all the time, but perfect example. Of course, I'm recording a video, so it wants to give me an error. In this case here, I'm going to, let's see, change the currency. I'm going to change this to just general. So that's getting rid of the dollar symbol. Sometimes little things like that are enough to screw it all up. So now we're going to save this and go back here, click the X, upload the file again. It should work. There it did. Okay, so another little thing here. Again, you'd imagine a multi-billion dollar company could solve for the fact that dollar symbols are there, but in this case it won't have it there. I suspect it's probably because you might have purchasers in different currencies, like euros and Japanese yen and US dollars. So for that reason, it probably separates it. But in that case, I would just separate those out into multiple uploads anyway. Regardless, name your audience exactly how you want here. You get about 50 characters. You know, you may add like, you probably don't need .csv. You could probably do some and add like the date. So you could add like today's date here. And then also for the description, you can add additional things here. It's a good idea to make sure you name your audiences so that they're easy to find. You don't get confusing. Believe me, it doesn't get confusing. Believe me, in the beginning, when you start uploading audiences, you're going to think you remember what they are. But I promise you, in like a month or so, it's going to get so cluttered. It's just not going to make any sense. So start with a good naming scheme. After that, you click next. Now here, it does a pretty good job at already understanding what each column is. In this case, we already marked that the value column was customer value. In this case here, we have country, we have email already matched up, phone number, so that's great. There are some actions. So in this case here, it doesn't understand what first name column is. So we're going to go here and select first name to map it properly, and last name. There we go. And then city and state. Just going to match it up. Boom. There we go. You're going to import and create, and it's hashing all the data, and now it's uploaded into Meta itself. Now, from here, you get a couple options. You can jump right into creating an ad. You can upload another customer audience, but another smart one to do here is a lookalike audience. So a lookalike audience, for those who don't know, in very simple terms, is it takes all of your customer data in this case, and Meta is right now in the background trying to find who these people are, trying to match up by email address, by phone number, by address, by first name, last name, trying to match who these people are to who they are on Instagram, who they are on Facebook, and then try to see what actions they take. What do they all have in common? Or do they have similar age ranges? Do they all live in a certain region? Do they all have certain socioeconomic levels that they're in? Are they all women? Are they all, you know, men? Are they all, there's a bunch of stuff. Do they all visit the same types of websites? Do they all take certain types of actions on Meta and Instagram? Do they engage with the same kind of contents? There's literally thousands and thousands and thousands of data points on every single person that Meta collects. And right now it's going through that list, trying to match them up and figure out what they all have in common. When you create a lookalike audience, you're basically telling Meta, okay, now that you know this about this group of people who are like maybe my purchasers or people who like added things to my cart or on my email list, now that you know this about them, go out and find me a certain percentage of the population of a certain country that looks just like these kinds of people. So if all of these are purchasers and you have hundreds of purchasers or thousands of purchaser data, upload that into Facebook or Meta, never get used to that. Meta will then go out and try to find you another 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5% of the US population or whatever country that looks like your core audience, or in this case, a seed audience is what you might call it as. So this is really, really cool. It's a very useful tool. Here, you just want to make sure you select the audience that you're working with. You want to select the country, United States. It's good to really do these separately. If you are going to do like Canada or Mexico or some other countries in here at the same time, I just do them separately, just again, to keep my mind straight on what I'm doing. Here, you're going to select the number. So in this case, if I were to just leave it as is, it's going to find 0 to 1% of the US population who most closely resemble this core audience here, this seed audience. In this case, it's about 2.8 million people. I like to create about 5 audiences, usually at a time. So I'll do 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and 4 to 5%. Each of these are about 2.8 million people in here. And it creates them all at the same time. Now, the people here, the 4 to 5%, are the least like the people here, 0 to 1%. This is the closest to your core audience. So this is usually your best. The only downside to this is over time, they tend to fatigue. So it's a good idea to start testing larger and larger lookalike audiences as well. So I'll usually start with including 0 to 1 or sometimes 0 to 2%, like these two grouped together, and see if I see some success. And when I start to see diminishing success, I'll start to expand out to 3 to 4 to 5. That's one tactic. You know, there's a million other tactics out there, but that's generally a good rule of thumb to start with. And that's it. You'll hit create audience. Typically, you have to wait like a day or so for this to update with all of the information. The more people you have in this list, the better these lookalikes are, because it has more data points and more commonalities to find on all of these users. So, yeah, if you like this video and found it helpful, please click like and go ahead and subscribe, but only if you actually found value in this. If you didn't, just move on to the next video. All right. Thanks so much.